Hey folks, Dr. Mike here for Renaissance Periodization. Today we begin the first of a five-part video series on designing your first program. So this is definitely a beginner program for general size, strength, and fitness in the gym. Let's get going. First, we're gonna do a series intro. Then we're gonna talk about the details of this actual video. What is the series intro itself? We're gonna take five videos to show you how to build a program for size and strength. It's a beginner program, so if you're not a beginner, you can still stay tuned in so you learn how to write programs for beginner clients you might have or beginner friends. And if you are a beginner and you have maybe done a couple programs before, but you really just wanna write your own for the first time that makes some good sense, this is definitely the video series for you. We're gonna build a sample program as we go. So at the end of this process, you actually have a sample program. You can change it however you like. Whatever sample stuff I have, some exercises you might not like, you can trade it out. You'll actually have a go-to free program to use. So that's going to be super cool. And then, of course, later you can always tweak and update as you become more advanced. This video today, we're going to talk about choosing how many sessions we're going to be lifting per week and sort of their timing and their duration, and choosing the exercises that you're going to be doing in your plan. Next video, we're going to choose weight and reps. Then we're going to have a video on how to progress from week to week to week to actually get better. Video four is going to be when to take breaks because your body gets tired. You can't just train hard all the time. And then video five is once you've taken a break from that first program and it's over, how do you build your next program, changing the sets and reps, changing the exercises, so on and so forth, so you can keep going and keep going and keep going. So at the end of this video series, not only will it have you learn how to build your first program, but you'll have sort of the code or the basic knowledge to build a bunch of other programs afterwards. All right. So for this actual video itself, we have to choose the number of sessions. So before you consider anything in a training program, you have to figure out, okay, I'm gonna go to the gym and I'm gonna train a certain number of times per week. Now, truth be told, the more often you train, generally speaking, the better. It's a kind of an asymptotic curvilinear relationship so that as you train more and more and more, at first it's a really big, so if you train once a week, you get meh results. If you train twice, you get way better. If you train three times, a little better than twice. If you train four, it's just a bit better. Five, six, whatever, it still goes up. If you do six, seven, and then double sessions and stuff, it still goes up, but it goes up by a tiny, tiny amount. So yes, more is better, but it's not much better, and there are some other constraints, specifically burnout. Burnout is real. Most people burn out of their first exercise program within a few months. That was not a slip up. Most people do. You want to design your program so that you don't end up like most people, because most people are not muscular, they are not strong, and they're not in shape. And most people have even tried it and they just burned out because it was too much. A lot of times, it's because people try to train too often. How many times have you guys heard, like, yeah, I'm gonna start changing things up. Maybe it's like New Year's resolution. They're like, I'm gonna go to the gym, 2 hours a session, five sessions a week at 5 in the morning. 90-some% of those people burn out because that's nuts. What you wanna do is be smart and start with something sustainable but effective, which means 2 to 4 sessions a week. 2 to 4 sessions a week, roughly evenly spaced between each other. So you don't wanna just cram 2 sessions Monday, Tuesday and take the rest of the week off. Maybe like Monday, Thursday, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, something like that, roughly evenly spaced, and about an hour long each. As a beginner, you can make excellent muscular size gains, excellent strength gains with just that little amount of training. Literally 3 sessions for an hour each within 1 week is an awesome stimulus that's going to get you great results. And look, if you're karate kicking the plan after a few months and just loving it, you can't get enough of training, you can always add another session, no problem. And beginners grow from almost no training anywhere, very little. Get your easy gains first. Make sure you're, you know, swimming in the normal kiddie pool first. Then if you want to go in the deep end later, you can slowly inch your way, no problem. You're not missing out on anything. It's not like if you don't start with 1.5 hours at a time, 6 days a week, you just never get any results. That's total BS. If you start easy, you get all the same benefits as if you start hard, but much smaller chance of burnout, injury, and all that other stuff. So in a sample plan, just for the one that we're going to follow along with for this video, you know, basically Monday, Wednesday, Friday is the split, and it's 1 hour of training every single time. It doesn't have to be any more complex than that. Now, what about the muscle group split itself? When do you train which muscles? Well, generally speaking, you train a muscle when it heals. And for beginners, especially once they catch on to the training process of things, their muscles are relatively small And of course, they're growing bigger, they heal relatively quickly. And beginners need a lot of technical practice. So similar lifts like leg lifts and lifts for your arms and lifts for your chest and back should be done relatively often so that you get good at them. Because if you train muscles really infrequently, it's like you did a bench press Monday and then you do it again next Monday, you're like, good God, I kind of forgot how to do this. If you have lots of pushing exercises all the days of the week, you learn better and you grow better. So beginners generally grow best by training each muscle every time they come to the gym. And thus, in most beginner programs that we write and the sample one we're going to write together, we're going to train whole body every session. If you don't want to train certain muscles, you don't have to. So whole body every session means that you train all the muscles you want to grow every session. That doesn't mean you have to train them all. For example, should you be training your forearm flexors? I do, because I'm trying to be on, you know, as good of a bodybuilder as I can. But like, you're a beginner, you might not have to. What, they grow anyway from normal training, and kind of who gives a shit how small or how big your forearms are? Calves. Do you have to train calves? I know this is blasphemy, but you don't actually have to train your calves. If you're totally fine with your calves looking the way they do, that's totally fine. Do you have to train your adductors, the muscles that close your legs, abductors, the muscles that open? No, God, no. You could just do the very, very basics. Here's another one, traps. Do you have to train your traps individually and do shrugs? No way, right? So just train all the muscles you want to. And the cool thing is, when we talk about later, compound exercises train a bunch of them anyway, and they even get the forearms, calves, and traps and all that stuff. So you don't have to be super specific. So whole body every day doesn't mean you need to go through like 15 different exercises to train every single physical muscle in your body. It just means all the muscles you want to grow, usually the basics, or you could just do upper body or lower body if you want. Every time you train a muscle you want to grow, you train it every single session of the week. So if it's Monday, Wednesday, Friday, you train every single muscle, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, right? Can you do it differently? Can you not do whole body? Totally. But we'll do a whole body example just so you guys can follow on, because it's a very good way of training. So here's the slide. The sample plan is Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 1 hour each time, but it's 1 hour whole body training Monday, whole body training Wednesday, and whole body training Friday. All right, exercises. Which exercises should you be doing? You can do any exercises that target the muscle. So if you want to train your biceps, you can do barbell curls, easy bar curls, dumbbell curls, alternating dumbbell curls, cable curls, machine curls, anything you want in the world. As long as that you feel your bicep generating tension during the movement, it's a fine exercise. But we can do a little bit better than that, because there's like a trillion exercises you can do in the gym. They're not all made equally, especially for beginners that don't have all the time in the world to train, which is probably something like where you're coming from. Compound movements, ones that use more than one muscle at a time. So you could do like a tricep extension, you could do a pec fly, or you could do a bench press of some kind or a press of some kind, which uses your pec and your tricep. It's compound because there's more than one joint involved in the actual movement and usually more than one muscle group. They have a couple of really big advantages, specifically three. First, they let you hit tons of muscles with just one movement at a time. If you want to train your quads, your adductors, your glutes, and your lower back, you can do isolation exercises for each one of those. That'll take like 30 minutes, kind of excessive. Or you can do a couple sets of barbell squats and hit every single one of those with just a few sets. It's a huge time saver. It's amazing. So absolutely for folks that are not professional bodybuilders, this is definitely the way to go. In addition to that, compound movements generally provide a high level of stimulus. So it's a lot of bang for the buck. It's not just that you train a lot of muscles. It's that every muscle a compound movement trains usually gets trained really well. If you want bigger pecs, it's not just that, well, ideally doing flies would get you really big pecs, then doing tricep extensions by themselves get you big triceps, but you're doing it together just to save time. If you're doing a close grip bench press, it's really going to grow your pecs a lot and your triceps a lot. So they're just good exercises in general. And if you're interested in that sort of thing, which a lot of people really are, these compound movements provide the best carryover, the best functional utility for real world strength and performance. If you want to get better at any sport, if you just want to be stronger for just being alive, you compound basics do it. So if you can learn to do deadlifts, eventually work up to doing repetitions with 200 pounds, which a lot of people can, you know, taking your groceries out of your car is going to be some kind of sick joke. Picking up your kids is going to be a joke, unless your kids are enormous and weigh over 200 pounds. So generally speaking, compound movements just have major advantages. So when we pick our exercises, we're probably going to bias our options more towards the compound movements. This may be different if we're working with advanced people, but this is for beginners, and that's how it works, right? We will also, from a motor learning perspective, because we want to get really good at certain exercises and get lots of practice, we're going to be doing a lot of the same exercises, but not always the same exercises day to day to day, because if we don't vary at all, we get this effect called staleness. If you do the same movement, same movement, same movement, first of all, you irritate the same parts of every joint and muscle, and then you can develop some chronic wear and tear injuries if you always bench press with the same grip with bench, 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 Monday, Wednesday, Friday, bench, bench, bench. Eventually, your shoulders might not like that sort of thing. And it's been shown that using some different angles and different, slightly different muscle group recruitment from the different exercises you're using can actually enhance muscle growth and enhance strength outcomes. It'll make you stronger every part of your movement day to day, not just a specific line of push. So we're going to use a little bit of variation, but not too much, kind of like a middle ground, right? And lastly, this is, I don't want to say this is a no-brainer, but I've been excited to design programs before and made this mistake. You only want to choose exercises which you actually have access to with your equipment and limitations and preferences. So first of all, if you don't like to do front squats, do you have to do them? No, there's tons of other quad exercises that work just as well. Some of them work better. If your back really hurts when you do a certain exercise for legs, but it doesn't hurt when you do another one, then yeah, maybe you have a history of back injury. Don't do the exercises that hurt. Maybe you can do them later in a rehab program and reintroduce them. But for now, don't do anything that you're limited by. And lastly, equipment stuff. Like if you don't have a leg curl machine, drumroll, you won't be putting leg curls in your program. Now, who is this being addressed to? It's certainly not people who are writing their own programs because, well, they know what gym they go to and they know what the equipment is. But sometimes a lot of us starting out in personal training, maybe online coaching, it's easy to write up an ideal program for someone and be like, here's your program. That'll be $100. And like, sweet, this looks great. The trouble is I don't have three of these machines. So the first thing you want to do after you know how many days someone is going to be training, after you figured out, you know, when you're going to be doing upper body, lower body, or whole body, you're going to want to kind of get a feel for what equipment they have access to and then choose the best exercises of that actual real world equipment that they have. All right, so just a sample. We've actually taken the exercises, just sample exercises, and put them in to this split that we have, Monday, Wednesday, Friday split. And as you can tell, there's some interesting stuff going on. One thing I want you to notice is on the first day, and on the third day, so on Monday and Friday, leg stuff goes first, lower body goes first, upper body goes last. On Wednesday, we're still a little bit tired in the lower body from the Monday workout. And if you train something last all the time, it doesn't grow as much. Because we want even priority with lower and upper body, we're going to put all the upper body stuff first on Wednesday. And then by Friday, we're back to the usual lower body first, upper body second. So yes, whole body every day is good, but that doesn't mean you have the same muscle group order every time. It's not like every day I show up, I train legs, then I train shoulders, then I train arms, then I do chest and back, and then I leave. Any program you design, what you want to do, if it's whole body or if it's a whole body program of some kind, what you want to do is one day you want to do legs first and then all the other stuff after. Another day you want to do maybe shoulders and biceps first. Another day you want to do chest and back first, so on and so forth. So everything gets a rotation to the top and gets its time in the sun. Everything gets a rotation in the bottom, so it has its time to heal up and really recover. And that's the way that really good programming works. So that's something to pay attention, even though I haven't written anything on here in these slides, that's definitely a key feature. All right, when you are doing the exercises, technique is number one. It's not a matter of just picking the exercises, it's also how you do them. Full range of motion is critical for the maximum hypertrophy that you can possibly get while being maximally safe and generating the most real-world strength carryover, right? A controlled descent is essential. So if you're doing a bench press, you don't go, ugh, and then press it off. You control the descent. It doesn't have to be super slow, but always under control. You never smash weights down. If you're doing a deadlift for general hypertrophy or strength, general hypertrophy or strength as a beginner, not as a competitive powerlifter, you're going to pick the weight up off the ground, and when you put it back down, you're going to put it under control. You don't just let it go. You don't slam the weight down. Okay, that under control also grows you more muscle because the eccentric part of the lift, the lowering part, is very, very hypertrophic. It causes lots of muscle growth by itself. Lastly, no body English. If you're doing curls, what are they for? They're for biceps. So whatever your bicep does, that's what moves. The bicep does, well, sort of three things, but in a barbell, your wrists are fixed. You can't do thing three, so you're left with two functions. One is to flex at the elbow, and two, the bicep also engages shoulder flexion. So a bicep curl can look like this, okay? It can look like this if you have dumbbells, because you can actually do the supination part of the bicep. That's totally fine. And it can look like this. At the top, you can lift your elbow up because the bicep functions like that. Notice I didn't say anything about the back, anything about the glutes, anything about the calves. So if you're heave-hoeing and curling and jumping up with your bicep curls, that's crappy technique because it's not targeting the biceps. And it's actually causing a lot of fatigue, which doesn't cause a lot of stimulus, which is just bad for everything. And it for sure enhances injury risk as well. Clean, good, controlled full range of motion is the absolute gold standard of technique. Keep that in mind. We have other videos. If you just search Renaissance periodization technique fundamentals, there's a much longer, more detailed video about what good technique really means. Because you're writing a program for beginners or you are a beginner, don't worry about that right now. You don't have to. If you want to Google it, that's totally cool. Now, if you want to save extra time, some of us don't have an hour to kill. Some of us may be down to 45 or 30 minutes at a time. That's totally fine. What you want to try is alternating supersets, all right? Here's what they are. Here's an example. You do squats for one set. Right afterwards, you go right to the hamstring curl machine and you do hamstring curls for a set. Notice the squat doesn't really train your hamstrings. It trains your quads and glutes and stuff like that. So your hamstrings aren't going to be tired after you're done squatting. You're going to be tired systemically, but your hamstrings are going to be fresh. You're going to have a productive set of squats, no rest, productive set of hamstrings. As soon as you're done, rest for a bit, maybe 30 seconds, maybe a minute. Get your breathing back, then hit it again. Squats and then hamstrings. You can do that for a bunch of different exercises. You can do bicep curls, superset to tricep extensions. You can do push-ups, superset to barbell rows. What that does is one muscle rests while the other one goes, then both of them rest as you catch your breath. It constrains the time much more so that you get tons of work done in a short time. Now, if you get super out of breath as a beginner, you still grow a ton of muscle and get a ton of strength. As a beginner, this is an awesome, awesome way to grow. If you're advanced, it starts to not work so well because one exercise for one muscle gets you so tired. Whatever that next set is doesn't work as well. So if somebody really advanced, big and strong, was to squat, rest not at all, and do hamstring curls, that set of hamstring curls is going to be a terrible performance. They're going to get half the reps they usually do. And not because the muscle is tired and limited, but because the system is. You're still out of breath. Your nervous system hasn't recovered yet. And that means your hamstrings are just getting the short end of the stick every single time. So, but as a beginner, this isn't a mandatory way to train, but if you have a short time, and also if you really like to keep the, you know, pumped up the intensity, you'll sweat a lot, you'll breathe heavy, it feels great, and it's kind of super fun. You plug in your headphones and go. As long as your technique is good, this is a totally cool way to train. Give it some thought, especially if you're short on time. All right, so to review, the too long didn't read version. First, choose the number of sessions that you can for sure commit to. So if you're saying, you're looking at your schedule and you're like, okay, I could do 4 days a week. Sometimes I have meetings on Friday and I gotta pick up the kids from soccer. And then someone says, okay, what about 3 days a week? You're like, 3 days I can for sure do. But I feel like I wanna challenge myself. Stop. The challenge is for when you're in the workout to work hard. The challenge is successfully going and actually getting the work done. The challenge isn't, can I fuck up my schedule enough and pick up my kids late from soccer practice? You know, your kids are standing there alone like, dad doesn't love us, right? That's not a challenge. That's just stupidity. So you don't want to go more than you can. Whatever it is you think you can do, for sure, that's what you can do. And if you have this other day, let's say it's just 2 days, that's totally fine. If you're like, yeah, I could maybe swing a third day, don't. There's no bonus points there. Consistency is king, right? Spread the sessions evenly in the week. So whatever you can make, let's say someone, you know, is designing a program that I'm definitely free Monday and Tuesday. I've had this happen to me before where I was a personal trainer. Like, I can make it Monday, Tuesday. Like, yeah. The thing is, not a lot of recovery time between Monday and Tuesday. And then you piss away the rest of the week not recovering or adapting because you're done with both those things. Can we get you to come in Monday and Wednesday or Monday and Thursday, ideally, or maybe Monday and Friday? They're like, actually, you know, yes, I can move one of my meetings from Thursday to Tuesday. I can make it Monday, Thursday. The thing is, you watching this video, or a lot of people that you coach and train watching or who are beginners, just may not know that there needs to be a bit of a symmetry. You don't want to cluster things. So first of all, choose a number of days you can for sure commit to. And second of all, whatever you get, whether it's 2, 3, or 4 days, spread them relatively evenly. All right, that's first thing. Next, when you're choosing exercises, choose the target muscles you want to train every session. Train every single one of them every session because you don't need super long breaks. You don't need to train a muscle once a week or anything like that. Choose mostly compound exercises because they are the most efficient and the most effective on average. You want to choose exercises that you have access to and focus on technique for those exercises above and beyond anything else. We'll get to load progression in the next video. Videos later, we'll address other things. But fundamentally, if your technique sucks, you're at a higher rate of injury, you're learning crappy patterns that are tough to unlearn later, and you're not getting the most bang for your buck. Technique is everything. And if you're short on time, consider alternating supersets so that you can knock out your workout in a short amount of time, still use good technique, get a ton of cardio work too, and that way you can be efficient. Not mandatory, just something to consider. In the next video, that's it for this video. In the next video, we're gonna talk about, okay, we have our sessions, we have the exercises, we're gonna figure out how to choose the weights and the reps for the exercises that we have. I'll see you next time for that.